हेलो लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, गुड इवनिंग। रे ब्रिंग्स यू इन द रे टॉक्स सीरीज एट अनदर विजनरी लीडर फ्रॉम द सीड इंडस्ट्री। आई वुड नॉट जस्ट से दैट ही इज अ विजनरी लीडर फ्रॉम द सीड इंडस्ट्री, बट प्रॉब्ली वन ऑफ द वेरी रेयर पर्सनैलिटीज हु इज got experience almost in all the agri input verticals of agriculture. I welcome, along with my always supporting and ever attending audience, Venkat Ram and the CEO, Managing Director of Seedworks International. Venkat Ram Vasanthavada, you are welcome.
Thank you, Davina. Thank you, Raj. Thanks.
It's always a pleasure, Venkat, to talk to you. I know now it's all virtual times. You still made it, took out the time in the most hectic schedule of this period. You know, seed industry is the most active amongst all the agri input industry currently. My dear friends, audience, I'll take you through a brief profile about Venkat. Many in the industry know him very well, but something which excites me about Venkat is, at times I envy him also, he has experienced many verticals of the business, right from FMCG, telecom, to all the agri inputs. Venkat has over 27 years of work experience with multinationals and large Indian corporates, which include DuPont Pioneer, Monsanto, Advanta UPL, Deepak Fertilizers and Petrochemicals, VST Industries, Voltas, and Real Value Appliances. Venkat's diverse industry experience is in areas of operations management, strategic planning, and business development. Venkat successfully built, continues to build, manage commercial organizations with sustained growth in revenue, profitability, market share gains, and geographical expansion. He executed differentiated go-to-market models and building innovative solutions in work situations in the areas of people development, sales development, and supply chain. Venkat worked extensively across Asia and Africa for improving farm productivity and farm incomes. Venkat has been awarded RMAI Leadership Award in 2016. This award is presented to outstanding contributions in providing leadership in rural markets. He also featured twice as the 50 most admired rural marketing professions in India. Venkat is decorated with a certified Six Sigma Green Belt. He holds a postgraduate diploma in rural management from IRMA, that is Institute of Rural Management, Anand, and is a graduate in dairy technology. Venkat, welcome to this webinar.
Thank you, Raj. Thanks a lot.
Now, when we bring Ray Consulting, when we bring leaders like Venkat on this webinar, we have a purpose. By now, you know, most of our audience are repeat audience. I'm happy, I'm proud, and it makes me humble that this is fifth in the series and audience have been repeatedly registering for our webinar series. This is the only company, institutions in the country who is trying to work to give a specific solution or deliver what a particular industry is looking for. Ray talks in this. We have AgriVision here from the leaders as this web series. As I mentioned, this is fifth in our series and first in the seed industry. Ray Consulting has expertise in entire value chain. We serve, as I mentioned earlier, clients in India, South Asia, and Middle East. We are catered to seed industry specifically. Just to quote an example, we have a couple of clients in seed industry. Last year, we were engaged by a small seed company and we helped them to grow their business by 47% in the very first year through various interventions. Ray Consulting transformed companies and individuals by benchmarking industries best, and we understand where you are and we exploit your potential where you should be, and we'll take you there. We also are in the conferences. We had Digital Ag India conference where Venkat was our keynote speaker and a hero because he gave some thoughts and ideas which attracted attention of many of the audiences. And we also do Agribusiness Summit and others. We have collaborations with ISB, ICRISAC, and NIAM Jaipur. In individual capacity, I facilitate board meetings, strategy meetings, and various other activities. I'm mentor to startups and technology-oriented companies. With this introduction about Venkat and me, it's time I start my machine gun aiming at Venkat. Venkat, all set?
Yes.
Venkat, before I ask questions on the industry, I want to know what's your personal experience on how this industry is going to behave, not only immediately, when I say industry, the seed industry, not only immediately next few months, but maybe next 2-3 years. How as seed works, you're working, and how as an industry, because you are very active in the industry, will you be looking at the changes that would be coming in? Yes, ma'am.
Thanks, Raj, for the introduction and for all the work which Ray Consulting has been doing, helping companies and, you know, bringing all the stakeholders into platforms for good discussions. Yeah, so I think all of us, the learnings what we had probably in the last, if I take from March now to we are almost in May, the last 2 months and probably, you know, this will continue for a couple of more months. These learnings and experiences, which all of us now we call by the term unprecedented and unheard of and all, we would never have had it in the lifetime, at least people like all of us in our generation and then many of us. So to that extent, I think, you know, while we were growing through these experiences, we also tried to look at things what we were doing, you know, individually as a company, but definitely as an industry too. And probably, I think, you know, once things open up for good, and if things, when they come back to normalcy, the new normal would definitely be different from what it is. So the businesses' approaches would get recalibrated, I would say. Recalibrated in the areas of how you deploy your resources, physical resources, because you know it. You have been a veteran in this industry. Huge deployment of physical resources happens. You know, for multiple activities, for farm advisory, for demand generation, for channel fulfillment and things like that. I would not say all that will go because there is an element of, you know, physical presence, which is still required given the industry we are in. But I would definitely say that there would be far more efficiencies, which now companies would bring in the way they approach the consumers, the way they approach the channel, or the way approach they used to approach a certain problem. So that is one big piece, which I would say in terms of our touch points, our programs would actually get, you know, kind of recalibrated in terms of the way we do things. So that is one big part of it, because that is where most of the monies are actually, you know, spent in terms of. The second bit is even in supply chain, and all of us, we have experienced it. Fortunately, we did not experience it much because most of the arrivals started happening and all, but we are experiencing that there was a lot of issues in the farm because there is a lot of labor deployment and lot of what one has to say, physical labor, which is involved. So probably mechanization, while it was happening, it would also be looked at it much more seriously in terms of people wanting to now go and deploy, you know, certain things which probably we were, you know, kind of avoiding. So I would also see that is the other bit of it in terms of, you know, the mechanization aspects and things like that. And the third one is physical settings, physical meetings, physical offices. Most of that what we used to do, you know, while they have to be there because there is some bit of a social interactions and meetings and all which have to take place, but they would also kind of, you know, get revisited. The same thing, whether you can do it in an alternate format, whether you can do it with much more efficiency. So I'm sure, I think these are some of the aspects which we looked at it. I'm not getting into the crops per se and all that, we will come to it later. But prima facie from a business perspective, I would say that these are some of the things which companies would look in and probably bring in much more efficiency and speed in the way their things are doing. Of course, there would be a little bit of things which we were doing coming back to normal. It can't be completely. Because see, one of the things in the agri industry, what we experience is, unlike an insurance product, unlike a banking product, we are giving the service physically. I mean, our product is physical. Our product is not something which can go electronically. So to that extent, that bit of a service element and that bit of a service delivery will be there. But for sure, I think there will be much more efficiencies and much more newer ways of doing things which will come. All of us, we have learned it.
Now, with that, seed industry's overview. When I say seed industry, you can club vegetables, row crops, and other segments, including fodder. What do you feel the seed industry's overview is currently?
See, if I would have to say, is the seed industry, fortunately, because this whole impact also, we did not see so much in terms of, you know, the hinterlands, the rural side. Secondly, what has also happened, because, you know, governments, both the provisional governments as well as the central governments, they're also pretty clear about not wanting to go and disrupt things there, or at least wanting to facilitate and enable things so that, you know, you don't get into the other issue of food security and, you know, stuff like that. So to that extent, life for people in the seed industry, at least in this critical quarter or run up to the quarter where, you know, we are, our arrivals were all coming, processing and all was coming. Probably we did not see a huge impact on a relative terms. Of course, it got impacted. Logistics were a nightmare in the initial days. Some of the arrivals, some of the production, you know, processes got impacted in the sense, you know, you had to monitor it so closely. So there were things which happened even at the marketplace and all. But to a large extent, I think probably, you know, delivering the seeds, ensuring that, you know, seeds reach into the markets and all was not a big issue. But yes, what definitely has happened is farmers started making choices. Farmers started making choices between crops. You know, depending on, like now we are hearing a lot about, you know, the seed, which is direct seeded rice. Now, how much we will know in the coming days. But the fact is transplanting requires a huge labor. And then there is also a gestation of, you know, you have to put a nursery and then transplant it later, also take care of it. So these are some of the aspects which we are seeing. Probably farmers would go also to crops in vegetables and all, which are largely not very short duration. If they think that, you know, there is an uncertainty in the shorter duration, so go for a slightly longer duration crop and then, you know, do the pickings later than prices. So I think farmers are making their choices within crops about how things will pan out, because for sure, some of the crops, the acreages, we would see some shifts happening. Of course, you know, that always happens. The cotton will interact with corn, or corn will interact with beans and, you know, rice and stuff like that. But today when the farmers are making choice, it is not only the commodity price and things like that, but it is also largely the ease of cultivating.
Yes.
You know, whether your crop will come out so quickly, whether it would require intensive labor management and all. So those are certain aspects which, you know, the farmer is actually looking at, if you ask me.
Now, this makes, I think, the companies are very, gives a challenge to the companies. The preferences are ad hoc. These are actually ad hoc preferences. Not that the farmer is looking that, you know, it's by choice. As you said rightly, you know, it's not about the marketing linkages that he's looking into the price or something, but he might be deferring, postponing, preponing, some of the activities. Now, how do you manage the inventory or supplies to various destinations?
Yeah, so I think that would be a challenge when we are getting into the new year, because this year anyway, whatever we produced, we have to see now how much would be left out and how much we have to carry forward. So I think there are different things which we are hearing at this point of time. If you look at a cotton crop, today I think the cotton acreages probably are not looking so bad. But how will the future play? Because you take cotton production simultaneously when you are also selling cotton now at this point of time. Because large parts of exports would have got impacted, because this is the peak time.
Yes.
You know, summer in European countries and all, that is how your yarn goes and all. So how will that play? Most of the exports in this interim got played off. And if you still have a 12 million hectares of cotton getting planted, what are the repercussions in the next year? So those are some of the things which are going in mind about how the crop would behave. Similarly, in corn, at this point of time, anyway, you know, it is slightly getting volatile because of output, because of chicken consumption, because also the food versus fuel debate and things like that. So I think these are uncertain times, and much more uncertainty is actually in vegetables, if you ask me. At least in row crops, there is certain vegetables. A farmer might make a decision in a jiffy quickly. No, I don't want tomato. I might plant oak, things like that.
Yes.
So I think, these are very uncertain times. So all we are doing, and most of the companies might be doing it, keep in touch with your farmers, monitor his crop, look at his output, look at his price points. But in certain cases where you have to take a production, because by the time the crop is harvested, there is no production. I would say, at least from the way I am coming from my perspective, I would rather play a little more conservatively than carrying out the seed and risking the inventories and the associated issues around it. And even today, if you see the rice crop, of course, this has got nothing to do with COVID. The hybrid rice, there is a general tightness in the supplies this year, largely because of the weather conditions. But I'm sure farmers in the large parts of eastern and northeastern India would have some challenge. Probably they might get it, but the quantities are not in the manner in which they used to be there because of huge challenges in production which we have faced.
So I know last year, I think production has been a big challenge, as it is inventories would have anyway come down this year for almost all the crops because of various reasons, especially weather playing havoc. Now, you use one term, keep in touch with the farmers, or for that matter, keep in touch with the channel. One of the facilitators in our industry is physical meeting, whether it is frontline sales executive or the field assistant, technical assistant, advisor. Now, with restricted travel, what are the means and modes the industry or you in specific are using to
keeping
your ears on the ground?
Yeah. So I think this has been a great learning experience for all of us. And I'm sure everybody is using it. The intensity might differ from company to company. You would not believe. In fact, the farmers are also much more receptive now to these alternate mediums. I mean, one is you can have a medium which is one way, where you are only, broadcasting things probably in a YouTube or in a Facebook, which can also be an interactive where he gives feedback, the WhatsApp groups, the voice calls and multiple other formats. So today what we have experienced is, I think the farmers are also looking at this mediums because they also know that that is the way they will get a communication or messages or product information. And I think the experience has been pretty good, both from the reception side, from the farmer's side. Obviously, one needs to keep working on to make the content more relevant to him rather than, just blasting messages about your products and your products and your products. I think there is a little bit of improvement which is required. But I think non-physical contact of not going to the farmers and still conveying your messages through these kind of mediums. Even Instagram. Farmers are there in Instagram.
Really?
These are some of the learnings which, we had. Facebooks and, this while they were there, YouTube. The Instagram has also been a good popular medium. TikTok videos, multiple other formats. And some of the things which we do internally, we have an AR product, which is an augmented reality product called Jigyasa. So you scan it and then you get, multiple features. Then we have something called an eSampark, where you can just send a link and then host meetings like what we are there. So these are some of the other alternative stuff. But sure, I think as long as you don't go and probably irritate the farmer, is just like any other consumer. We get multiple calls from companies, randomly somebody saying you want to buy a credit card. I think probably we should not overdo it. As an industry, I'm telling you, then we should have much more relevant messages. Now, that will only happen, Raj, if you know your consumer, if you have the right customer database, if you have rightly sliced and diced it and made those segments, then you can have probably purposeful and pointed messages to that section of people rather than doing a carpet sweep and then getting into all these issues of spam calls and spam messages. Yes. So that is something which one has to learn. And secondly, this whole app-based thing, today, there is an over this thing around the apps, if you ask me. Everybody has got an app. So, I mean, what is the differentiation? And every app, everybody knows that, that app will only talk about their company products, general advisory will give. As an industry, we need to graduate in that aspect. And this is more of an industry level thing, which we have to do. But from a company level, probably the best time to do is, I mean, Raj, you know that in our times when probably, we were all working in the field, all of us, we used to have database, Excel sheets, notebooks, hamare field assistants, TFAs. It was all sitting with them and wo chala gaya to wo database bhi chala gaya, phir dusra wala aake chala. Today, with the help of the digital media, I think that is the power we have. If we can get this database right and if we can do the segmentation and analytics around it, we would actually really be helping farmers. Companies will get benefited, farmers will get benefited, and it will not be a spam and a general, irritation call which concerns. But I think that is where we found a lot of benefit around, using these mediums. But I would say this is just we started. There is a lot which you can do. But the primary thing is to you need to build a right database and you need to slice and dice your customers and segment them for reaching out to them with much more purpose.
And see, this will also increase, as you know, from Instagram to you mentioned WhatsApp and Facebook. The digitization will penetrate.
Yes. Definitely, it will penetrate. The huge benefits out of it, as all of us know, the speed of response would go up phenomenally. It will be much more real-time response. And probably, see, what typically happens is our field assistants, MDRs, frontline sales officers, while they do their job with all the honesty and sincerity, some of the problems which are much more scientific in nature, probably today there is a lag. Because you can't solve, he has to relay it back to his agronomist and then he finds a solution, then relays it back. With the digital medium and if we can have meaningful interactions, probably the farmer can directly interact with the right people wherever they are virtually and then get a solution for his problem.
I mean, yeah, I know. I mean, with this media, probably industry or company of yours can always arrange a quick video call.
Yes.
Or, I mean, if get the answers instantly. You don't, they exactly. don't need to wait. That's great. I think that's a nice thing. Now, you mentioned a little earlier, they might, you said the farmers have started making choices, not just about crops, but the cropping pattern. Like shift of crops, it's known mainly because of the marketing linkages, ke price nahi aaya bhai, uska shift kar do. Jiska price sowing ke time pe jada, wo crop padta hai India, incidentally. Now, Telangana government, for example, I think I was told that even Haryana is planning that they would guide the farmers which crop they should be cultivating. A. B. Like practicing totally different way of cultivation, like rice you mentioned, from transplanting to direct seeded or what we call a seed cultivation. To what extent will this sustain? I mean, if the farmer practices this cropping pattern this year, do you anticipate they'll continue with that or they'll get back to the original old practice from next year?
See, this is a very debatable one. The first thing about, the government's advising farmers to crop a certain category of crop or within that a certain variety and all. Like in Telangana, we are seeing they're asking, please grow cotton or please grow fine rice and not the coarse rice and, stuff like that. This is my personal opinion and probably, industry. One is, I think the objectives always are very, very noble, Raj, whenever the governments do it. I mean, I don't basically try to, question the objective of it, because the intentions are always noble. Yes. But unfortunately, what happens is when it comes to execution, A, B, even when your intentions are noble, probably, you know, you should have taken the industry together in that, because there are people who have produced now a certain category of seeds for the farmers to grow. And then you are suddenly asking them to change into a certain crop. Whether it will happen or not, we will have to wait and watch. This puts industry also into some kind of a trouble, because we will be ending up with inventories which are
logistics. Not yes, inventory. That's exactly
but,
I was.
Yeah. But principally, if you ask me, I think, and this was always, you know, was a, this thing in my mind, that why do farmers do a certain crop when you know that the investments are pretty high? You are, you know, not so much abundant with resources, and then you get into some problems of, you know, indebtedness and things like that. So this was always, why do farmers grow some very cash intensive crops, putting so much of money, while they can grow some hardy crops and get at least, you know, some bit of it. So I think from that perspective, there is an advisory if it is very strictly followed, if industry is taken into consultation, and if it is all the stakeholders who are part of that are, you know, can co-create the whole thing, probably then it might be successful to a certain extent. But then if there are ad hoc measures of doing it all of a sudden and all, then, you know, there would only be some kind of a confusion and a chaos in the marketplace. But otherwise, you know, in fact, you know, to tell you, there were attempts like this made earlier also.
Okay.
I mean, wo Jeep campaign mein cotton mat dalo. कॉटन डाल दो, जिस दिन कॉटन नहीं डाला वो कॉटन के प्राइस बढ़ गए, फार्मर बोला कि अरे यार ये क्या हो गया कॉटन के. सो आई थिंक दीज आर ऑल मार्केट फोर्सेस, एंड वन ऑफ द गुड थिंग्स व्हिच हैज हैपेंड इज नाउ वी हैव टू सी वेदर इट विल गेट इनटू द लेटर एंड प्रिंट द वे इट इज द होल एसेंशियल कमोडिटीज एक्ट एंड वेयर यू नो फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर निर्मला सीतारामन टॉक्ड अबाउट सेइंग दैट दे विल कम आउट ऑफ दैट, एंड प्रोफेसर अशोक गुलाटी सेड दैट दैट इज अ वॉटरशेड मूवमेंट इन द इंडियन एग्रीकल्चर लाइक द वन व्हिच we have witnessed in 1991 when the Indian economy was opened up. I mean, it's really a big moment if at all these things happen. That would basically give access to the farmers to markets. Then he make decisions. So that is a much more evolved and an informed system where then you are leaving the farmers to make choices. Now, this particular thing is somewhere in between kind of a thing, and then slightly rushed in the last minute. As an industry, we made a representation to the Honorable Chief Minister as well as the Agriculture Minister of saying that, you know, this is coming in the last minute and we all are stuck with certain kind of inventories which we have produced anticipating that. So we don't know what will happen. But for sure, there is a merit in this. But I think it has to be a much more consultative process, taking all the stakeholders into account, and then requires a planning, not in the last minute. That is what I would say. The second part is, farmers would make choices. Farmers would make choices not because of one of course, you know, some of the diktats by the governments and all, but largely because of the, you know, resources he has got, the way he is foreseeing some of the things spanning off in the next few months and all. Basis that he will actually, you know, make some choices around that. But then this whole theory, which is, you know, even Professor Gulati also mentioned that this is actually, you know, this is a very interesting theory. This is called as the Cobweb theory. Cobweb theory mein, typically yehi hota hai ki every farmer will grow because you have grown, I have grown. Yes. Second year, it will be a glut and again, we will all circle back and all. That is all because of a lot of information asymmetry, which is there in the marketplace where the farmers are not knowing how things are going to pan off and all. Probably some of these things, what the government is talking about will ease. And will make it much more, the farmer might participate it. Probably he is now the most unfree guy in the, you know, our industry or our this thing, while he produces food for all of us. Probably he will be much more, you know, informed and entrepreneurial. But wahi hota hai, while that has happened, you know, we are seeing this also where farmers are being dictated. Haryana, I have not heard about it. Haryana, what is it? Haryana, long back they did this, na? Saati nahi grow karoge.
You will I not know. Yesterday I was talking to someone from the industry. So he was also mentioning the similar thing. We need to wait and watch how things will shape up. But as you rightly said, I think one thing is that, you know, why not a discussion happen from the producers or from the industry? And then take their views.
That is what I'm saying. It should be much more stakeholders. Everybody should come in. And, you know, definitely one can decide, one can help the farmer because these distress situations can be avoided and all. But if it happens in the last minute and in this kind of situations, so we really don't know.
It's a valid one because it not only it helps you to manage the inventories, but also helps you to prepare, educate the farmer in a problem.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. See, what happens, like you remember in our Digital Ag India conference, Vice Chancellor Professor Dr. Praveen Rao mentioned about this. You know, farmer goes for a particular crop in a particular area, but season or the other things may not be suitable to them for not, if not for any reason, at least for the crop duration. Even 15 days to 130 days duration, plus or minus, changes the entire scenario of his productivity. Great, Venkat, I think we are going good. We spoke about the crop shift or the variety shift happening this year. And last year had been a challenge in terms of production for the seed industry. Do you anticipate any changes in crop production, I mean seed production for the next year, business year? Because this year, all of you will be taking production, of course, cotton to begin with right away and over the period of time, all other crops.
See, the only way you can build a more sustainable production is, you know, what is typically happening today? Location diversification, spending a lot of time in understanding the agronomy of that crop to educate them to grow. So everybody is only flocking in those areas which have been a traditional areas. So I think industry, while diversification has happened and then continuously, it has to happen with much more intensity. And then probably, you know, we'll have to keep scouting more newer and newer areas, do the seed production research there, and then, you know, establish the production. Because these kind of weather challenges would continue. And if this is the case, probably every year we would see, you know, production shortages or some or the other crop, you know, which will. And also, you know, one can't build so much of inventories. I mean, believe me, companies like our size and all, and even if you have money, it is foolhardy to build inventories of 1 year and then block your working capitals and things like that. So the only way one can do is that go aggressively on location diversification, put a lot of investments in agronomy, in understanding the crop, in trying to, you know, model it around. And the third one is obviously, you know, look at also doing a lot of training and capacity building at the farmers level. That is also the other aspects. Today, because we have a certain favorable agroclimatic conditions in certain geographies in the areas in which we all stay or probably in the states, most of the production is happening, which is very natural there. But I think diversification is something which we have to look into. Otherwise, we would definitely get into these challenges, the cycles of short production, then excess production. Yes, companies which can hold inventories, companies which can hold, you know, lock their working capital for a longer period of time might probably be able to, you know, sustain and take advantage of this. But then that is not the right way, you know, of building a business. I mean, how much more you can lock? You can't build 2 year stocks in 1 year just because he's an achar. So the only way of is aggressively looking at, you know, location diversification, agronomy, and probably also getting varieties and products which are much more, you know, producible and at the same time also remunerative to the farmer when he grows in terms of yields. So some of those things also have to change. Yes, that is one most fundamental
thing. Very critical.
You know, in a seed industry, I've always seen the product which is the most popular product is the most difficult to produce. Or jo sabse easy produce hota wo bikta nahi. So this, I mean, crop after crop, we see suddenly one crop. So I think somewhere we have to, you know, strike a balance around these issues.
I think with so much happening in the industry and so many challenges and facilitations, I'm sure SeedWorks, I remember when you joined the board of SeedWorks, you did mention to me that you're on a vision, next few years, 3 or 5 years thing. It's about 3 years, I think you are.
Yep.
Yes. So will your planning change because of the situations, or you would be more aggressive and then see that is aur kya kuch nikal sakte hai?
Yeah, that is a very good question. So I think probably, you know, we are all blessed, Raj, that we are in a sector which is actually addressing the fundamental issues. जो मैं किसी और में भी बोला था, द रोटी कपड़ा मकान में रोटी हम एड्रेस कर रहे हैं. सो टू दैट एक्सटेंट, एज लॉन्ग एज यू नो देर आर ह्यूमन बींग्स इन द प्लैनेट एंड दे विल कंज्यूम फूड, वी ऑल इन द इंडस्ट्री हैव टू सर्व देम. सो दैट इज वन थिंग. आई मीन यू आर इन आवर इंडस्ट्रीज माइट नॉट बी वेरी ग्लैमरस टू टॉक अबाउट, बट आई थिंक प्रॉब्ली वी सर्व वन ऑफ द बेसिक थिंग्स विच इज रिक्वायर्ड फॉर एनी ह्यूमन बींग, द फूड, ऑल ऑफ अस हु आर पार्ट ऑफ दिस इंडस्ट्री. So to that, and even in fact, yesterday I was actually, you know, reading, I was attending a webinar by KSA Technopark, you know, CEO, who was addressing a lot of CEO conference. Food and groceries will continue to be one of the biggest areas. He's still projecting post-COVID also, it would be at a CAGR of 10%. And that is actually the biggest basket of our consumption. You know, then comes clothes and apparels and then jewelry and stuff like that. So I think we are in a sector which will always be, you know, required, because if you have to address the food. Having said that, within that, you know, okay, what about seed works? See, today we are still making inroads, probably into hybrid rice, into cotton rice. We have been a little more, you know, older in the system and we have some good market share position. Cotton, we are still making inroads. We have added millet and mustard to our portfolio. So I would always say that, you know, there is enough scope for companies to participate, as long as you probably give meaningful solutions to the farmers and then give them the right seed solutions. I think one can always create a space. So post-COVID or pre-COVID, probably the resolve has only become much more stronger, saying that, yes, you can do things probably much more efficiently and with much more speed. And there is also a lot of responsibility on people like you, me, and all the others who are working in the webinar, because the country is also looking up to us.
Yes.
About how do we stand up and measure to the expectations. We talked about COVID barriers, the health workers, the municipal workers, these police and all. But then there is a silent set of barriers who are here, who are actually helping the country produce the food along with the farmers. Definitely, he's, of course, at the forefront. So probably I think... I don't think our plans would have changed. Only thing, the resolve would have gone better of saying that, yes, we can do things. Yes, there are a lot of learnings which we had. Probably this year would not be an year like any other years. But on a relative basis, probably, you know, when we look at industries besides us, we feel that, you know, our impact has been actually a relatively lesser to that extent.
No, you're right. I mean, coming to the webinar series, I mentioned in the beginning of the webinar, Venkat. So the whole purpose why we started the series was that, that you know, food, feed, fodder is a very critical part of the ecosystem,
yeah,
survival. And on the lighter sense, in I think last, since about a month, I got at least some 7 or 8 serious inquiries from non-agri industry entrepreneurs, biggies, asking me, Raj, suggest us ke hum agri mein kaise involve honge.
Yeah.
Looks like this is the only business which can sustain us. And they are the guys from real estate, media, event, from the film industry too. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm happy that, you know, it has attracted so much attention.
Exactly.
Right from, you know, processed foods to even, I mean, some of them have a couple of 100 acres of land. They came to me and said, Raj, no, no, monsoon is just around. Tell us, what do we cultivate on this?
Exactly. Yeah, so, no, I think agriculture, actually, you know, I'll tell you, unfortunately, there is a reverse migration which has happened of the guest workers who were working with us. It should not have happened. But anyway, I think mostly, most of this reverse migration which has happened back to the countryside, well, of course, there are different theories which are being played. For sure, agriculture will find a lot of resonance with most of them. Agriculture and, you know, things around agriculture, it can be dairy farming, it can be sheep, pig, multiple other aspects of it.
See, regarding this reverse, labor going back to their respective villages or their natives, we anticipate two things happening, you know, at Ray Consulting. One is probably they'll go and form up agriculture then. A. B, on 3rd June, Jatin Singh would be talking with me on how monsoon will impact this prodigy labor, how farmers or farming would manage without the labor which hitherto were working in their farms. So hopefully, I deliberately put it on 3rd June because it's just onset of monsoon. So
yeah,
you address accordingly. So from there, Venkat, we of course little later, because I'm also seeing a lot of people raising their hands, we'll surely take a few questions from the audience. Besides reading, we'll try and interact with those people. Now, when you are journey of attaining your vision, I'm sure you're ahead of your plans, I'm sure, because the way the aggression, the things are in place, your team, the way you build the team in such a short time, you're the best in the industry whom you are hired. I see that happening. You also take, I would say, intervention from the consultants. So you feel that they add value?
Yeah, yes, yes.
भाई हम तो हमारे पास भी consultant है.
No, they definitely do that, you know, because in our journey too, we have, you know, we work very closely with one of the consultants in defining our strategy roadmap, mission, vision, goals, and, you know, probably values, everything. They definitely add. See, what typically happens is there are two ways to look at working with consultant partners, and you are one of them, and we know that. See, there are organizations or there are CEOs or the senior leadership which would like the consultant to tell what he wants. So then that doesn't work. And I have experienced it in my earlier of that.
I know
so,
that.
Yaar, usse bulwa do. The second bit is if you are very open to suggestions, because there would always be a critique in the way you were doing things to what he would do, because he is a complete third party. He doesn't have any biases. He's only doing it for your good. Probably they can always be. If you are following the second path, you will be hugely benefited. I mean, as an organization, we are, but you have to be open to listen to the feedback. Sometimes listen to probably some of the things which you might not like. So I think the second one, if it is being done, then it will no longer be a bookish kind of a thing. Probably you can get a lot of insights. And I would always say that consultants, third party, you know, objective review of what you are doing always clearly helps, because you would know better what we are doing than while I would know it, but I would not know a part of it, the critique piece. So yeah. I think, and everybody has benefited out of it, depending on the size of the company, you know, different types of consultants, different specializations and all. So, and the third one is sometimes what happens is when you want to take a group together, it always helps to have a third party who can then, you know, seamlessly integrate them. And then, you know, because you all bring in a certain kind of an expertise, which probably we do not have, because we are all practicing managers. We are only, you know, operational in nature. And that is a, you know, big art. And I have seen them. They're absolutely cool, composed, don't get rattled. They will take all the inputs, but then, you know, bring home to a point. So I think, you know, I have usually benefited out of it, Raj, I should say. And I would always say that, you know, they add a lot of value. Of course, there is a lot of other things which are being spoken about, but it all depends on how you want to take it.
Yeah, I think, as you rightly mentioned, consultants bring a neutral view or a apolitical view from outside. And at the end of the day, they work with the industry benchmarks. Where you are, where your vision is supposed to go, whether it is possible, if possible, what are the interventions required, things like that. Great. Now, India's exports you spoke about from the seed industry, what would be the value approx, Venkat, out of that? How is it going to contribute in this Atmanirbhar Bharat or Make in India project kind of stuff? Will it earn good revenues?
Yeah, so I think probably, you know, the ballpark revenue numbers I would not exactly, you know, remember at this point of time. But, you know, I will come to the areas in which. So this whole Atmanirbhar Bharat is actually being interpreted in different ways. And, you know, of course, everybody is interpreting to his own convenience. See, we should be self-sufficient, definitely. I mean, absolutely no issues. So there are two ways to look at it. And specifically, let us talk about our industry, in the seed industry. We, in fact, do a lot of export. We do a lot of export of probably commercial seeds also, which we sell. Because there are two ways. One is you sell hybrid rice, you sell corn. Probably you also sell, you know, multiple other, you know, small vegetables and things like that. But then India, because of the advantage what it has got on the agroclimatic conditions, we are also a huge production base. Probably countries like Philippines, Vietnam, Thailand, most of this, because of the challenges of the weather and because they are not blessed with so diverse agroclimatic conditions, we also do a lot of custom production for many of them. For large multinational companies, the most of the seed is produced here and it is exported. Even it is for us because we have a subsidiary in Philippines. Most of the everything is produced here. So to that extent, I think, this is one more bucket where you can be a big seed production hub. And vegetables, you know about that. You know, there is a lot of custom production of vegetables which is done. And probably we also saw shifts from China to India because of the labor arbitrage and things like that. The only thing where, we have to work and improve on it is the huge quality aspect. We have to bring in much more transparency in terms of the quality specs. Lot of investments around that. And then if we can crack that bit of it, probably I think we would be a much more, preferred destination. Africa, we do a lot. Most of the countries, about that. Africa also depends on export. So the Atmanirbhar Bharat is, while you are self-sufficient for your production, of course, we do import. We do import vegetable seeds to say. Yeah. Otherwise, I don't think, cereal crops or any of the things, there is any need for any imports because we produce everything what we want and probably we also export it. Now the Atmanirbhar Bharat, as I was telling you, the interpretations of that, at least as far as seed industry is concerned, yes, you can be more Atmanirbhar in the way that are you putting your plants with the local machinery, probably most of the equipment is still imported. I mean, you have the best in class seed plants are having machineries, which is from Simria, Spetkas and all of those. Try to develop a lot of machinery. In mechanization, you can do a lot of things and then, develop tools which are, more related to our small and marginal farms and things like that. But as far as seed is concerned, probably I think, there is a lot which is anyway happening internally only. But yes, areas of, there are other areas where one can do a lot of things, which I keep picking up from my industry friends and we're also reading and all within the agriculture space. Digitization, probably you can do a lot because India is a powerhouse of all these, things. Because we are a startup nation. We are a startup nation. Then we have, a large army of technically qualified people, entrepreneurs and all. That is one aspect where I think probably we can do a lot of disruption, if you put it. And we are also seeing a lot of startups here. So most of the IoT, the smart farming, the internet, the tools and all, probably that we can do and improvise. We can do a lot of customization because the small and marginal farms, we can only understand it. Nobody from North America can understand this space, neither from Europe. So if we can understand this space because we have been here and since we have this large tech force with us, that is one aspect where probably we can actually give it back to the entire world, a lot of things, at least in the continents which are served by the small and marginal farmers. So that is one aspect which I am, pretty bullish about it, the whole digitization aspect.
Will this, in that case, will this work as one of the diversification opportunities for the ag industry, more so specifically seed industry? Because in seed industry, I see a lot of, because seed industry mainly has got a lot of researchers involved at every level, I mean, both at the breeding level and the technology level. The technology deployment is seed is much more than any other agri input industry. So you feel that companies will pick up as another vertical, say for example Seedworks itself.
Seedworks. I think space. you know we have a digital function which is we have Pulkit who is heading that. So the way we would look at it is it is not one more vertical. Probably can you redefine the whole business model through digital? I mean digital is all encompassing across all the functions. In definitely, as you are saying, in research, we have a huge, huge opportunity to do it. There are experiments which are being done at this point of time. Obviously, scalability is still being, deliberated. Supply chain, huge. On consumer facing in sales and marketing, there is a huge bit which can be done. So I think it can cut across all the, functions of a seed business. And you can make it truly, truly digitally enabled. And there is a huge, I fully agree with you, there is a huge opportunity. If not today, probably some company will crack it. Today, if you look at it, large multinational companies have put a lot of money around this. but they're actually, you know, trying to work on large farms. Most of their experiences and their learnings are in the large farms, and they've done a lot. Largely, you know, when you talk about a smart farming or a precision farming, what it is, in a large acre of land, you know, you can pinpoint the fertilizer usage to a small patch, do the optimization around that and stuff like that. Similar kind of things can be done even in the small farms, right? From fertilizer optimization to your breeding acceleration, to your supply chain predictability, and, you know, developing models where you can predict the outcomes much more reliably to your understanding of the consumer. So I think seed industries, today, most of them are putting in money. Let me be very honest with you. Putting in money as one more vertical, but this has to be a part of the business.
Okay, that's
exactly. Then it will happen. I will also talk about in an evening seminar with you. But are you really getting benefit out of it? Is it cutting your cost? Is it improving your speed? Is it improving your profitability? Is it improving your understanding of the consumer? Aspects like that. But I think, I'm sure there is no way out. We have to walk this path. And as you are rightly said, yes, seed is much more intense. So we will find a lot of benefits around it.
Yeah, I think digitization is one of the greatest tools to integrate the internal customer from company's point of view and exactly the external customer.
Yes.
That would surely happen. Venkat, anything from your end? If I have missed something, otherwise a lot of hands have been raised. We can go to some
few. No, I think I would be happy to take questions. But the only last one which I want to leave is, we have talked about many things. COVID, pre-COVID, post-COVID, how things will pan out. One of the important things, and this is something which is very close to my heart, people are the most important one, because anything you do, even digitization karna hai, product karna hai, people are the most critical aspects of it. What digitization has also taught Raj, from the times we were there when we were monitoring everything, physically going there and all, today's generation, and probably post-COVID times across any generations, you have to empower your people sufficiently enough, because you can't physically keep going everywhere. Empowerment of people, delegation and empowerment part of it, which still does not come so generously to most of my experience, to my janta tumne. That is one bit of it. Element of trust between employers and employers has actually radically got redefined. Today, in a digital world, in a virtual world, I'm not stepping out, neither you are stepping out, but the last guy in the chain is also not stepping out, but he's carrying his work. So the whole, element of trust has actually got refined, and we have to work on it and only strengthen that. And the third piece of it, engagement definitions have now changed. How do you engage your employees? And so I think the whole people aspect of it, both in terms of engagement, in terms of empowerment, in terms of trust, huge lessons which we have learned. I'm telling you, at least from Seedworks, we are 355 people. I should say I'm blessed, because there are many variants who are still working on the front end with minimum or no supervision, but because of a huge ownership and accountability, which they have felt that yes, they have to do this, they have to do it for themselves, they have to do it for company, they have to do it for the country. So I think all of us who are leaders should also relook at these aspects and try to build models which are, you know, different. Largely the employee-employer relationship. That's what I just want to.
This point I would say, Venkat, I know you since Monsanto days. You know, when we rallies and Monsanto had a tie-up, even then you said, Raj, aap karo yaar. So yes, delegation has been one of your biggest strengths. And yes, you're blessed with the right people, because people love to work with a great leader and the vision. And you empowered at every level, I know. So closely. That's something that's great strength. So we will check who is, Venkat, compliments to you, man. From second one up to now, it's more than an hour now. The number is constant. You are also watching on the screen.
Thank you. Yeah.
Number is constant, man. No, not a single drop. Otherwise, this is something I keep repeating after 35, 40 minutes. Oh, people start, you know, thing. But even now the number is same. I'm taking screenshots every 5 minutes to check what's thing happening. Great. So Anit is also there with me, part of our consulting. Let's check, Anit, who are on the thing, who have raised hands, and then we we'll take questions from them. And if they're willing, we can take them on video.
We have a lot of questions, and I think if you go through, can I get Professor Shashi Vemuri to answer live on that? Can I get him to talk?
Yeah, sure.
Professor Shashi Vemuri, just a minute, please.
And check with them if they're okay, we can take them on video.
He's put a question. I'll just get Professor Shashi Vemuri. Yeah, we can hear you, Professor. Professor Shashi Vemuri, could you unmute yourself, please, and put forward your question to Mr. Venkatra? Professor Shashi Vemuri, can you hear me?
Yeah, he has to unmute.
Yeah, he has to unmute.
Or else he can send a question through chat.
He's already sent a question.
Oh, is it?
Okay. You can read out that question.
Yeah, I'll do that. So, Professor Shashi Vemuri says, what sort of scenario you are expecting in the coming season and how the horticultural farmers will respond to the present government direction in Telangana that they have to plan crops as per government crop plans?
Yeah, I think we discussed about this. So, that was an advisory, as I was telling you, and I think we had a long conversation with Raj also around that. The intentions, as the government says, you know, and always, I would say that the intentions are always honest. They are very noble. The execution part of it, and probably I think there is not enough consultation which has actually gone ahead with the farmers. So probably I would say that there is certain, some amount of what one has to say, anxiety would always be there in the farmers about why one is saying so. Why does somebody want me to plant an X crop versus a Y crop? So to that extent, we don't know how things will pan out because the season is round the corner. Obviously, you know, there are certain measures which the government is taking to ensure its implementation. But probably I would say a consultative process would have been a far better, and the outcomes would have been much more certain than today at this point of time, the last minute one. So honestly speaking, I really don't know how things would pan off, how things would pan. So this is what the government has said, this is an advisory, not advisory, it is actually beyond an advisory that you have to plant this. But probably irrational or, you know, an education around why we are saying so would have been much, much more better and would have resulted in probably outcomes being very close to what one is expecting. That is what my answer would be.
Subhrajit, are you online? You can take Subhrajit Nath.
Yeah, just a minute.
He's raised his hands.
Yeah. Yeah, we have Mr. Subhrajit.
Yeah, he is again muted.
Yeah, he has to unmute himself.
Yeah. Okay.
Subhrajit Nath, if you can hear us, could you put forward your question, please?
Yeah, is it audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Yeah, hi, my question is because we are one representative of Wintersteger Austria and Seed Processing Holland from different companies. Is it audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Can you keep your microphone?
Yeah, closer to that. Yeah.
Actually, we are the representatives of Wintersteger Austria and Seed Processing Holland from different principal companies in India. And we are the manufacturer of R&D mechanization machineries, like a seed work, because seed work is our global key customer worldwide. So my question is, now it's a problem of migrant laborers because they went back to their native place. So all industries having problem with labor or manpower. So what will be the effect in our mechanization business towards the seed industries in India?
See, I was telling earlier too, I think mechanization theoretically should actually take a jump start.
Okay.
Jump start because, you know, these issues, this is a wake-up call. Independent of this wake-up call also, at least I know in Seedworks, you know, my supply chain head Raja and all, they have been also looking at experimenting with multiple things, you know, with mobile dryers and stuff like that in hybrid paddy. So, and most of the other companies would also be trying to do some things.
Yes.
So while that was going on in a pace which was probably okay, whether it will happen or not, doesn't matter much. But today with these challenges, probably it should take a jump start and people will start finding out more and more solutions. But one of the things, Subhrajit, I should tell you is that companies like yours, which are large in size, which are multinationals,
yes,
you know, you should also be willing to be open and to start experimenting on some collaborative models, on trying to do some things which are much more suitable for, you know, the smaller firms,
yes,
or much more suitable in addressing some of those, you know, issues. So these kind of investments, which would be, you know, by both the partners on this side, as well as large companies like yours who are into mechanization on the other side, would definitely help us in finding some, you know, solutions. But the other aspect which I have been reading, you know, we are talking so much about these guest workers going back, well, they're written back. You know, some of the analysts, and I'm not an expert on the migration part of it, you know, they would be returning sometime, if not, you know, probably this season or this year would be slightly different, because there are a couple of things which we need to understand. The land is finite. Even back in the village, it is not that the land has actually, you know, gone up and suddenly there was land which was not being tilled or grown. There was somebody who was growing the land either through a remote means or through, you know, different other formats which are there. Probably, yes, the intensity of cultivation might not be so serious. So if I'm farming my own land, I would, you know, put all the right inputs and then get the best out of it. That bit of good work which we can see. But beyond that, until unless the government of India or the local state governments, MNREGA is only one small part of it. Until unless you do a lot of employment generation, either through agriculture or allied services or probably industries and all, they would be very, very challenging to find that kind of an incomes which they have in the city side, in spite of all the hardships.
Yes.
So while this is something which we all are experiencing and witnessing, part of it would still continue like the way it is, because there is a lot of panic, and rightly so, because if I am also away, I would like to go back and do that. But then what would typically happen is there would be some migration back again. Having said that, learn the lessons, mechanization should take a jump start, and people would now look at it much more seriously. But the only request to companies like yours is that you should be willing to partner on models, which the outcomes might be sometimes uncertain also. That, yes, that is what my take is.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. We can have one more from, I think, Mahesh Somani. Are you there, Mahesh Somani?
Yeah. 1 minute. I'm just unmuting him. Mr. Mahesh Somani. Mr. Mahesh Somani, you can ask your question.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, we can.
Please introduce yourself, Mahesh.
Yes. I'm Mahesh Somani from Pune.
Yes.
We are, I'm working in agri-tech company. So we are providing applications to various agri-input companies and agri-industries. Custom-based applications, web, iOS, or Android. So, as earlier spoke Venkat sir about the digitization and electronic media. So, I just want to. I'm expecting the scope. I'm asking about the scope post COVID-19 for the digital digitization in agriculture.
So I think, Mahesh, I spoke about that. There is a huge scope. There is a huge scope. Everybody will walk this path. Not that people pre-COVID in agriculture, at least there were, you know, attempts being made by most of the companies around this area. That will only get amplified better. But only thing, Mahesh, you know, as a company which is engaged in, you know, making digital products or, you know, solutions and all, one needs to be, again, I would say, you also have to bring in some disruptive thoughts, because otherwise what is happening is, you know, most of the products are looking very, very similar in thing, and then people are deploying it. So one is making some disruption into the way you package your products and present your solutions to the part, to the companies. And the second one, more importantly, is that one needs to also establish a return on investment on that. Otherwise, this becomes a completely, you know, one of the fancy ideas which is there. Because Mahesh, you would understand, you are from the tech area. This is a huge change my internally in the companies, because all of us, at least we have been in this industry, used to doing things in a certain manner. And then this is basically new ways of doing things. So to that extent, again, you know, partners like you, you should also involve beyond giving a product or a solution to ensure that, you know, the clients meaningfully appreciate and then take out, you know, whatever benefits out of it or demonstrate it. But I'm sure, I think there would be a huge scope for, you know, companies like yours or people coming out with solutions around this space.
Yeah, I think we'll go for one last check. Yeah. If Rakesh Reddy is there.
Mr. Rakesh is not online.
Okay, probably good.
Yeah.
So we still have a lot of hands raised, Venkat.
You can send the questions otherwise, and then probably I will answer it and then...
Yeah, we have... that's a good idea. You can write to us on the same email ID through which you have received...
Yes. I can answer and send it to you back.
Yeah. Through which you have registered. That we forward those questions to Venkat. And then we'll forward the responses back to you guys. Venkat, thank you so much. The number is still intact. It's like a movie, you know, from start to finish, it keeps you on grip.
Good.
Thank you
for the opportunity, and it was a pleasure talking to you as well as talking to some of the members who were asking questions. So, you know, these are also learning experiences personally for me, where you can share, you know, some of the learnings or experiences you are going through. Like I am actually talking to you in this webinar, I have been participating in multiple webinars,
yes,
more as from the other side. And there is a lot of learning which has happened. And I think thank you so much for the opportunity, Raj.
Always pleasure, Venkat.
Thank you.
Thank you
All
so much.
Best. Take care.
Yeah. Thanks, audience. You've been, incidentally, we can't see you, but your number which shows us on the screen makes us feel that, you know, each one of your ears and eyes are on us. And I'm sure Venkat's interaction today must have given a lot of what we typically call as FAQs you had in mind. The whole intention of having this Ray Talk series is that, you know, we don't generally want to speak what everybody speaks. We don't want to give that sahanubhuti or empathy or sympathy feeling. But we would like to give little guidance to the industry and take back, as Venkat rightly said, you know, he participates in various fora and he brings back to the audience. So similarly, we all learn quite a bit from your participation, your questions. So keep doing that. Keep sending us the questions. We have our next webinar on the Ray Talk series on 3rd of June, same at 4 p.m. I would be talking to Jatin Singh, Managing Director and Founder of SkyMet and Founder of GramCover. Jatin, you know, he's like a weatherman for India. And SkyMet predicts weather for the country and rest of the world. He would be talking effects of monsoon on small holding farmers and prodigal migrants. And we'll see, government is doing so many policies and, you know, we have the shramik things running around trains. Will it bring back farmers, or the farmers will stay back in their own villages and then try and do something better for agriculture? So Jatin would be emphasizing on rural economy as a whole rather than just on agriculture. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much. Thanks, Venkat.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.